We're getting off to a little bit of a late start, but a few things going on. I want to welcome everyone to, this is the fourth time that we've done this all Unmanned Systems Business Expo. First year we did it, everybody told me that I was crazy or crazier, that this wouldn't work. But it does work, and it's a great venue for people to come and hear from professionals and learn from people who want to, let's say, use this technology in positive ways and try and do it legally. So I know you're gonna, the speakers are all experts. And I know you're gonna have to learn how to earn legally. There's a lot of misinformation out there about what's legal, what's not legal, how to be legal, yada, yada. You're gonna hear how to do all that legally. And I want to thank all the speakers who came out here to speak at this thing. I know that they're all busy people. It's great. We record all of the sessions, and the reason we do that is we put on our YouTube channel later. You can go and you can watch these, and people go back years after and watch these presentations to learn from them. I know that universities also use these presentations for classes. I hope to also in the future. We also try and stream it. We didn't get that working, but we'll do what we can. So a little housekeeping stuff, you are right here at the Golden Gate Club. I know the map might be a little hard to see. Those of you with yellow dots on your name tag means you get lunch, which will be over here in the Hawthorne Room. If you don't have a yellow tag, you do not get lunch. But there are other places to eat. There's the Transit Cafe, which is close by, the Walt Disney Family Museum's Cafe. Bowling alley, the officers' club has a restaurant, so there are some other things around here for you guys to eat. The other thing that we'll need to know is tomorrow there'll be a reception hosted by Drone Deploy, and that will be at the commissary, and we'll go there between 5:30 and 7:30, and there will be snacks and drinks, and that's hosted by Drone. So what you're in for is 39 presentations, one discussion panel, we got 20 exhibitors. The product demonstrations, it's kind of an insurance snafu that I don't want to get into. So we may see one, a free shoots demo. And then the SF Drone School is going to do a totally FAA compliant drone selfie thing. So, be on the lookout. Did you get the drone selfie, the FAA compliant drone selfie thing together?
Yes.
Okay, good. So be sure to come by and check that out at lunch. And then that's pretty much it. Again, yellow dot at lunch. No yellow dot, no lunch. Oh, and then the other thing we're going to do is there's a hat out there near the poster on the table. You drop your business card in there, and tomorrow at lunch, we are nice people at Boomerang Carnets. So if I win it, don't be surprised. Okay. But we'll remind you again. But be ready for that tomorrow. I also want to thank our sponsors. These people helped me put this on and helped keep it at a price point where business people can afford to come, which I try and do. I really, at sUAS News, our ethos is to try and educate the community. And these people help us do that. So support them. Okay, now we're going to roll right into the presentations, and I'm going to open the show as I usually do. And I'm Patrick Egan, for anybody who doesn't know me. And I work with sUAS News. And I hope everybody here read sUAS News every day religiously, twice a day. Yeah. But he doesn't read sUAS News, we have to talk. Anyway, okay, so I'm going to launch right into this, and we'll try and keep on the schedule here because we have a lot of speakers. This, I got this from a UK newspaper, and I think what it tells us is that we've got a problem. If 58% of people polled believe that drones freak them out. We're doing a poor job as a community of getting the word out there about what drones can do for the rest of us. And so it'd be nice if we could work on that. Part of my presentation is going to be talking about that. I think that we have an issue with some of the claims. I'm in the news business, and I see people out there in, with news stories and Twitter and all the rest of that. And it really starts to frustrate me when I see people make these types of claims that are up here on the board. The 333 thing, we have like the 333 King. We have people, you can rent my 333 until yours comes out. We have people that are offering 333 services that don't mention any of the legal stipulations. Oh yeah, come on down, get a 333 and you're good to fly. The consensus amongst people in the industry is that maybe, I'm always generous where I say, I don't know, what is there now, like 4,900, 5,000 333s, and talking to different people in the community, I think I'm generous when I say that maybe 20% of people are in compliance. I know that other people think that it's less of a number than 20% of those people. A lot of people don't even realize you need a pilot's license, things like that. So we're not doing a good job educating people on how to do this legally. The other one is the FAA certified flight schools. I don't know that that's true. Some of the hype, the world's smartest drone. Other people are self-proclaimed drone experts. I see them all the time hanging their shingle out. I'm the drone advocate. Well, you know, what do you know about drones? Well, they're neat, and I bought a Phantom, and I fly my Phantom around. That's not really an expertise in my book. Another one, there was another study that just came out. A lot of the times people liken drones to birds, which I think is a mistake. Drones are not birds. Birds are organic. They have an innate instinct to kind of try and survive, one. The other thing is they're not made up of metal. Birds don't have metal bones. So likening them to drones, I think, is a little bit of a stretch. One of the last, studies I saw, somebody threw a number out there that we wouldn't have a drone collision. One drone collision in 374,000 years of operation. I'm going to call BS on that one. The other one, I don't know why this keeps happening, but people want to do drone events at airports. And it's like, to me, it's stupid. We have a problem where we have drones at airports, and that's starting to freak people out. The beauty of the whole drone thing is that you can do it, it's an off-airport operation. You don't need to be in an airport. And I don't know if you guys, whoever follows me on Twitter, I'm out there and I try to tell people, hey, you know, you've got to, you shouldn't be showing videos of you flying your drone at airports. One example would be the video from the Mexico City airport. People are like, nobody even saw that. 436,000 views. A lot of people saw that, and I'm sure that there's some people that want to emulate that, and they buy one of these drones, run out to the airport, and fly it to try to get the same type of video. Very hard to re-educate 436,000 people. The other thing, people are making claims that they have products and apps and other things that are going to manage the airspace for us. Airspace management is a very difficult task. Some people have been air traffic control. I don't think the cell phone app is reliable enough or certified for air traffic control. We'll probably hear more about that later. We'll hear from NASA too on the UTM thing. And the other one that we always hear is technology always wins, and that's not always true. We're seeing here with what's happening with on the regulatory front that our favorite technology is not winning. I would say that it's kind of frustrating. So bottom line on that is, you are the company that you keep. And a lot of people, I won't associate with people I see as snake oil salespeople or people that are making false claims. And the reason that I don't is I don't want to give them any credibility as they're destroying the industry I want to be a part of. So another issue that we have to deal with, a lot of the drone companies, there is no QA 2012 reauthorization bill, drones and aircraft, people have tried to have their feet in both camps and say, well, I'm like an amateur, and these aren't aircraft, and then when it suits them, I'm a drone pilot, yada, yada. We got to work on our script. The other thing is the hype cycles. I think it's totally out of control. And I got my little skier up here. He's got a little GoPro on his helmet. And he's skiing down here towards the trough of disillusionment. I think that the community, in some cases, has been almost its own worst enemy. I think a lot of companies planned and thought that the FAA was actually going to make that September 2015 mandate. Shocked that they didn't. So, I know. You know, some of us have been at this for a couple of years, but I think people kind of ran out of money. And then the last, right before the chasm, there is the registration task force. I'm not happy with what happened in the registration task force. I think that the 250 grand number was a totally arbitrary number that was pulled together by Ministry of Defense report. Talked about 250 grams could be fatal. That is true. On the task force, I don't think we had good representation because we didn't have anybody there that knew anything about engineering. Because there's a thing called material density. If I hit somebody with a 250 gram steel projectile or a lead projectile, yes, that could be fatal. If I try and hit you with 250 pound or grams of packing peanuts, that'd be hard for me to do damage. I do not think that that was taken into consideration for the registration task force. I had it out with some of the folks that were on the registration task force. They told me, oh, well, we wrote into the recommendation that the FAA could not use the 250 gram risk threshold in the future. And we're a polite company, so I won't tell them what I said. But fast forward into this micro arc, and 250 grams is like the established risk threshold now for the NAS. So I hope everybody enjoys their unregistered, uncertified, under 250 gram drone, because that's exactly where we're headed. 2016 for me is the year of intellectual honesty, and I've been putting it out there, and let me just say that I'm getting lots of pushback on that concept. I think we have to be accountable as an industry. We can't be making false claims. We have to be responsible. We have to take the lead in our own with the other folks, the other stakeholders that are already in the NAS. That's another thing a lot of people don't understand in the drone community. I think we first kind of went through that when we were on that small USR, there were some veterans in here. There are other people already in the NAS. You know, there's the GA people, there's the 121 people, 135 people, there's, you know, hang gliders, balloonists, and everybody else, and the NAS already has rules. So the drone community is kind of like, we're the new kid on the block moving into an existing framework. A lot of people don't understand that. Another thing I don't think they understand is that the FAA isn't like dealing with the city council or the permit office or something else. The FAA is charged with making the NAS safe. They have a lot of people, 50,000 people doing that. They have a huge budget. They do a really great job with the 121, or 121 people, and even GA is pretty safe. So if we're going to want to get into that, I think we're going to have to prove as a community that we understand what that means, or we understand the seriousness of moving into a safe space. So, you know, I always tell people, hey, you know, you have to think about the community or the business that you want to be in. I think that the registration task force, again, if you look at this guy from Atlanta Hobby, since the recommendations were released for the task force, his business is down 70%. Most of the consumer drone manufacturers I've talked to, their sales are down. We've all read the news, what's going on with 3D robotics. I think we're going to see more of that here in the future. The other thing we have here is another clip from the micro arc. I don't think that people understand what this means. For over 250 grams, they want to do some industry consensus performance standards. there's some people that have been on ASTM and on TCA, which have participated in both of those processes. That has been going on for over a decade. I asked about this on the call. I said, well, who's going to do the industry consensus standard? Well, we don't know. We don't have that figured yet. Okay. So I'm hoping it's not going to take another 10 years. But the thing is that that really is the sticky wicket here is the manufacturer of the U.S. certifies to the FAA that the UAS does not, you know, failure, blah, 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 going to cause serious injury. I do not believe that people in the consumer drone industry, the OEMs, understand what that means, certification. Or they probably would have not went along with this. I wouldn't have went along with it. I'd be like, whoa, this is pretty hairy. Anyway, all of these types of mistakes are going to lead us to what I believe is a no drone zone or a limited drone zone where it's going to be very hard to make money. I think that's another thing. When this SFAR 107 comes out, there are a lot of people in the community that believe that we're going to be able to do whatever we want. You're going to be able to fly wherever you want, fly at night, fly beyond visual line of sight, and they're dreaming, because that's not what's going to be in 107. So, I think that we need to focus and our message, and also when we go out there and represent ourselves in the community, I think we need credible and qualified advocacy representation. I do not believe that this community has any qualified representation at this point. I think we need to manage the hype, you know, with the drones. I think people are making, you know, just wild claims, and we can't deliver on those. And I think that's going to erode our credibility in the future. I think we need to focus on a business or civilian use message. And really just get away from the military stuff. I've been talking about that for a while. Although with the military stuff, I will say that if you watch what they're doing, their airframes are staying pretty much the same. It's kind of the, let's say, traditional aviation style. I think we need science-based integration. I've been beating this drum for a few years. The community or the drone manufacturers should put up some money to do some scientific research to understand what the risks are to non-participants on the ground. Also to the GA community, what are the risks of these small aircraft hitting like a 172 control surface, wing, windshield, prop? I've tried to talk to people about this. The manufacturers, I've suggested they put up, you know, some money. They all push back. The FAA is going to do some testing. Okay, well, fair enough, but who do you want to ask the questions? Do you want the FAA to ask the questions, or do you want to ask the questions? I usually get a shoulder shrug, which tells me that people don't understand the FAA game. I see the company spend a lot of money on sending people to exotic locations all around the world to take drone selfies. To me, you can get those photos free on Instagram. It'd be much better to spend that money on science. That's me. Global harmonization. We have to realize in Europe they have, you know, 5,000 certificated operators where we have 5,000 exemptions here. It's a little bit of a different process. The other thing is some of the stuff that happens over here migrates to other parts of the world. Whatever the FAA does, most of the other CAAs follow suit. That's another dangerous proposition for the people over there because they're already flying. I do talk to some CAA people from Europe, and they're like, well, there's talk that we should follow the 250 grams. I don't know if you want to do that. The other thing I've been beating the drum for a long time is regulatory accountability. I think people are afraid to ever really publicly say anything about the job that the FAA is doing. I've said it over the years. I've been a little harsh on the FAA, but after all, I believe process should be a two-way street. Some people that worked at the FAA have felt my wrath. Bruce over here was the industry co-chair on the small UAS arc, and I gave you probably 10 months of hell, Bruce.
I had a full head of hair back then.
Exactly. And it wasn't anything personal, but you know, Bruce was representing the FAA at the time, worked at the UAS. And so Bruce kind of educated me on the mechanics of how the FAA works. That was his job. So we're buddies, but at the time, it was Bruce was definitely in the hot seat. The other thing, you know, the thing I've been preaching for a long time is I'm into this. People are like, well, you know, what's this Egan guy's angle? My angle for this thing has always been to advocate for small business and to create jobs. And through the, I don't know, 12 years that I've been doing this or so, I've seen a lot of people, you know, lose their businesses, lose their houses, lose their marriages. They put everything that they had into this business and kind of have sat there and watched it all kind of dry up and go away. And the real sad part of that is they watch the illegal operators go out there and make a boatload of money. And they watch the illegal operators, you know, get pull the plug and work and do movies and TV or sell their companies for millions of dollars or get VC funding. And that's the real sad part. There's been a lot of people that have been hurt by this. And so anytime anybody might ask you why I'm like let's say, vocal advocate, or I'm maybe a little harsh to some people, that's my focus. And anybody that I see that's out there diminishing the viability of this technology, you're going to hear about it. I don't have a problem with people making money. I just have a big problem with people making money, let's say, and destroying this industry for the rest of us. So that's all I've really gotten to say this year. I don't really have any words of encouragement. I am waiting for, supposedly, the SFAR is going to come out in a month or two, is what they were saying. I don't think that when it comes out, that all the parts and pieces will be there and we'll be ready to go, and the starting gun will be fired for the drone rush. But, you know, I remain optimistic after 13 years that we'll get something we can use. The other thing I wanted to talk about today is Eileen's here from Monarch, and I thought this was a really great idea. She wrote this children's book, Daisy Saves the Corn. And it's this nice, good, wholesome story about how a drone is actually out there doing something good for the rest of us, helping feed a hungry world. And were you able to bring any copies for sale? They're out on the table. So this might be something, if you have a little person in your life, this might be something you might want to buy and share with them, or also even share with your friends. I think it's a great idea. And you're working on another one, right?
Yeah.
What are Daisy does search and rescue, or Daisy saves the day? All right. This is a good example, I think, of what we need more of. You know, we need to get out there and show people that we're not trying to spy on them with our drones. So with that, I'd like to invite our first speaker.